Good morning. It's good to see you here this morning. A couple things to bring to your attention. First off, I think most of you have heard, but some of it hadn't. Orville Murray passed away Friday afternoon. And so he was over, Wednesday night we were here. We were told that Donna and Sarah had taken him to Alma, to the hospital. We fully expected them to get him feeling a little bit better enough so that he would sign himself out and go home. But that didn't work. He did want to come home, but they told him they weren't bringing him home because he was not well enough. Well, Friday, things took a fairly significant downward turn, enough so that they called a life flight helicopter to take him down to St. Vincent's. And he was in a quandary. He had congestive heart failure with fluid buildup, and he was dehydrated. So they couldn't give him fluids because he had the fluid buildup. They couldn't give him something to get the fluid off because he was dehydrated. They got him loaded up on the helicopter, started towards St. Vincent's, and not long after they took off, he just flatlined. And they started some resuscitation efforts and came back to Alma. And when they got off, they were doing the resuscitative efforts. And Sarah and Avis told him to stop. Orville had had a do not resuscitate. I don't know that he had signed an order, but that was his wishes. And so they shared that. So the funeral will be Wednesday here at the church. Visitation will be at 2. The funeral will be at 3. The grave, he will be buried at Mill Creek Cemetery. We will be feeding the family after the service on Wednesday. So if you're bringing food, if you're coming to the service, just bring it and put it over there in the social hall. If you're not going to be able to come to service and you can get food here by 3:30, it would be much appreciated because we will feed them. Because of all of that, we will not have any Wednesday night services this week because we will be tied up with the funeral and feeding the family and then clean up over there. I do not know if Aaron and Rebecca, if Aaron will get to come home. He didn't get to come home when his other grandfather died about 4 or 5 weeks ago. It was right around the same time Miss Linda Ann died, that his other grand, what was his last name? Harris? No. Harley Harris? Okay. But anyways, that's right. I was confusing myself because of Orwell's last name. Mr. Harris. So I don't know if he'll get to come home. Ashley got in Friday about lunch. And so I don't know. Some of his kids will be coming in. So that's why they're waiting until Wednesday. But if you want to carry food by the house, you can carry food there to Miss Donna's. But again, we'll be feeding the family after the service on Wednesday, so your assistance with that would be much appreciated. I know that they had planned there had been something by the pastor appreciation lunch to do today. I think that's been rescheduled, just in light of the events that take place. And so, Sherry, we're going to do that the week before that Sunday before Thanksgiving. We're going to combine that with our Thanksgiving lunch. Okay, it doesn't make sense to do two different things in the same month. Just put them together. It's less cooking that has to be done. So that will be then. Wednesday night, two were added to our prayer list, Freddie Walker, Charles McCollum, Miss Clara Dixon, who's visiting with us today. Glad to have her. We added her to our prayer list. So those are just some updates. Just be in prayer. When we were over there at Miss Donna's Friday afternoon, she was just a bundle of energy, just constantly moving. And Miss Betty told me, so that's how she deals with it. She just stays busy. But be in prayer for them because it was not anticipated. But Orville had some idea. He had said something to me a couple of weeks ago on a Wednesday night about he wanted me to be a part of his funeral, and he mentioned several others. And he had already given a songs to Ray. Anyways, just be in prayer for the family. All right. Sherry, Teresa, why are you hiding back there? Oh.
We were going to do pastor appreciation today, and Pastor Joe's birthday is the 8th of this month, and Miss Jan's is the 31st. Seventh. But we had already ordered the flowers, so we were going to go ahead and present them to her, and we would love to tell you happy birthday.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. We love you.
All right. Thank you all for that. And with that being said, let's open up with a word of prayer as we get started this morning. Father, we come before you today, and Lord, we pray specifically for the Murray family and all the extended family of Brother Orville. Lord, just last Sunday, he was here with us, both services. And this Sunday, Lord, the family is not able to be here because they are mourning his passing. Lord, we sometimes call it untimely. But Lord, we know that in accordance with your will, all things happen and occur on your time frame. And Lord, Friday was the day that you had chosen to call Brother Orville home. I thank you for his testimony, for his witness, his love for you, for his service to this church over the many years. So we pray for Miss Donna, pray for Ashley and Avis and Sarah and all of their families. And Lord, we pray for this church family. We've had a lot of death over the past this church has experienced it since COVID, but just in the time that I've been here, Lord, we've had a number that have passed. And so, Lord, we pray that your comfort would be felt by the members of this church. Lord, that you'd still use us to be a vessel to reach out into our community and to minister to others. Father, we pray for your blessings now upon this service today. We pray that the name of Jesus would be just put on display, that Jesus would be lifted up in this place. Lead us now in this time of worship. We ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning. If you are able, let's stand and sing "There Is Power in the Blood." Stevie Sweat, will you lead us in prayer?
Thank you.
Amen. You may be seated.
Savior art thou, if ever.
shall find rest beyond the river.
Heather's getting the young. Heather, y'all going out this door over here? We're going to let them get out. Then, got a video I want to show you. It's a music video. It's by David Crowder. Some of you have heard of Crowder. The name of the song is He Is. And I had thought about doing it last week because where we're at in the Gospel of John, it speaks of who Christ is. But in light of all that's gone on this week with the passing of Brother Orville, I thought it'd be appropriate for you to see this because it'll have the words up there. So I wanted to let them get out first. It's good to have the sound of little voices. Sometimes they're a little too loud, Blaine says, but still good to have the sound of little voices. All right, Jeremy, you can start that video.
If your trouble heavy hearted, come to Jesus and find your peace. If you're run down, empty handed, come to Jesus and find your strength. He is hope for the whole. Rest for the weary, help for the hurting. He is mending the broken, bearing the burdens, all that you're needing. He is. If you're wandering the Prince of Peace, author and maker of everything, defender, deliverer, King of Kings. He is helper and healer forevermore, savior and shelter through every storm, my refuge, redeemer, and Lord of Lords. He is child of heaven and son of man, protectors, the great I am, Alpha.
Take your Bibles and go with me to the Gospel of John, chapter 6. We want to pick up with where we left off last week. Who is Jesus? And I'm going to read these verses again, beginning in verse 41 of John 6, going down through verse 59 of this chapter. So if you have a copy of God's Word, if you don't, it'll be on the screen. I ask you to stand with me as we read God's Word together. The Jews then complained about him because he said, "I am the bread which came down from heaven." And they said, "Is not this Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How is it then that he says, 'I have come down from heaven'?" Jesus therefore answered and said to them, "Do not murmur among yourselves. No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up at the last day. It is written in the prophets, and they shall all be taught by God. Therefore, everyone who has heard and learned from the Father comes to me. Not that anyone has seen the Father except he who is from God. He has seen the Father. Most assuredly, I say to you, he who believes in me has everlasting life. I am the bread of life. Your fathers ate the manna in the wilderness and are dead. This is the bread which comes down from heaven that one may eat of it and not die. I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. And the bread that I shall give is my flesh, which I shall give for the life of the world." The Jews therefore quarreled among themselves, saying, "How can this man give us his flesh to eat?" Then Jesus said to them, "Most assuredly I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day. For my flesh is food indeed, and my blood is drink indeed. He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me, and I in him. As the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so he who feeds on me will live because of me. This is the bread which came down from heaven, not as your fathers ate the manna and are dead. He who eats his bread will live forever." These things he said in the synagogue as he taught in Capernaum. You may be seated, and let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we ask your blessings upon this time today. Holy Spirit, we ask for your provision, for your enlightenment. Help us to see what it is that you are saying to us. And Lord, you invite us to be in a life with you, to be in relationship with you, to be fully committed to you. Lord, the Bible knows nothing of half-hearted commitment. Lord, you call us to follow you completely and to follow you at all times. Lord, we don't always succeed in that. We're not always living for you as we should. There are times of sin in our lives. There are times of where our faith is weak, where our faith may be shallow. But Lord, I thank you that in spite of all of that, that you love us, that you care for us, and that you provide for us. So Father, help us to listen and hear what your word says to us today. May I just be a vessel through which your word flows. And I ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, you'll remember, just to remind you, that Jesus had fed the multitudes, had multiplied the fish and the loaves of bread that the little boy had there. He had fed over 5,000 men, probably somewhere close in the neighborhood of anywhere from 12 to 20,000 people, counting women and children, that he fed. And they took up 12 baskets afterwards. Well, after he did this, the people wanted to take and make Jesus king. They wanted this, I mean, someone who could provide them food without them having to go out and labor for it. And so then that led to Jesus. When they came seeking him, he said, "Don't labor for the food which perishes." He said, "You seek me not because you saw the signs, but because you ate the loaves and were filled." Verse 27, "Do not labor for the food which perishes, but for the food which endures to everlasting life, which the Son of Man will give you, because God the Father has set his seal on him." He said, "You're seeking me because you want something from me." Too many people come to Jesus because of what they want from him, instead of just surrendering to him and allowing Jesus to use us to be a blessing to those around us. We want what Jesus can do for us. And if Jesus doesn't do what we think he ought to do for us, then we say, "Well, I don't want anything to do with him." We reduce Jesus to a genie in a bottle when we adopt that mindset. We come to follow Jesus regardless of the cost. As I've mentioned before, there are believers today that are sitting in a jail cell, that have been tortured, that have lost their homes, that have had their churches burned down because they are following Jesus. And is it not worth it? He is worth it. And we sit in our comfort and we have very little stress, but we look at the trajectory of the way things are developing in our culture, and the day is coming to where we may be paying the price that believers in other places in the world are paying today. And if Jesus is not enough for you now, he will not be enough for you then. You need to know that Jesus is more than enough, and Jesus is talking to them. And so when he tells them that he is the bread of life, back up in verse 35. And this is the first of the I am statements that John records for us that Jesus made. Remember, here he says, I'm the bread of life. He would later say in the 8th chapter, I am the light of the world. He says in chapter 10, I'm the door of the sheep and the good shepherd. I am the resurrection, the life. I am the way, the truth, and life. And I am the true vine. The I am statement. When Moses asked God, whom shall I tell them has sent me? What is his name? Tell them, I am that I am. I am who I am. God, eternal, the eternal God was speaking. And Jesus, when Jesus said, I am, they understood clearly what he was saying, that he was making himself out to be God. Not just making himself out to God, be God, but declaring himself to be God in the flesh. And so in verse 41, we began last week looking at this section. The Jews complained about him because they knew him. They said, how can he say, I'm the bread which comes down from heaven? I mean, how can he even claim to have come from heaven at all? Is this not Jesus, the son of Mary and Joseph? I mean, we know his father and his mother. Another passage says we know his brothers and his sisters. How is it that he says this? And Jesus said to him in verse 43, do not murmur among yourselves. Then he makes a bold statement. He says, no one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him. He said back up in verse 37, all that the Father gives me will come to me, and the one who comes to me I will by no means cast out. Here he says, no one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up at the last day. Listen, there is no one who wants to be saved who cannot be saved. If you have a desire to be in a relationship with Christ and to be saved, and remember, we've already looked in John 3, that is a biblical term. It sounds odd to the world today to tell somebody, you must be born again. You must be saved. And they say, saved from what? How can I be born again? That was the very question Nicodemus asked. And our culture looks at this and says, that's odd. That's weird. That's different. But it's biblical. And if you want to be saved, it's a result of the Spirit of God working in your life, drawing you unto the Father. In Romans chapter 10, the Apostle Paul says, or beginning in verse 8, he says, but what does it say? The word is near you, in your mouth and in your heart. That is the word of faith which we preach. That if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. There is that phrase again, being saved. He said, for with the heart one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For the scripture says, whoever believes on him will not be put to shame. For there is no distinction between Jew and Greek, for the same Lord over all is rich to all who call upon him. For whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. We have a need here? Don't know? We see the door open up. You know, Halloween is this week, but Miss Sandra and Miss Jan will have new rides come Tuesday. Miss Sandra's birthday is Tuesday. Isn't your birthday Tuesday? I thought so. Her and Jan share a birthday together. Happy birthday. Early, in case I forget on Tuesday. I distracted myself. But he says here, whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. You're not going to call on the name of the Lord except the Spirit of God is dealing with your heart. We have had in America over the past 100 years what some would refer to as this easy believism. This, if you'll just pray this prayer, and if you really mean it, then you're saved. For salvation to take place, it takes the work of the Holy Spirit working in an individual's life, drawing them unto Christ, to understand that they are lost without Christ, that they are a sinner, and that because of their sin, they deserve hell. They deserve judgment. I was reading an article the other day. It was talking about how very few preachers anymore preach about hell. Hell is a very real place. Everybody believes in heaven, and nobody really believes, I say nobody, but there are a lot of people who don't believe in a literal hell. They believe it's just something that Hollywood has made up, that preachers preach to try to scare people to increase attendance and offerings and these kind of things. Hell is a very real place. Jesus spoke about hell as much as he spoke about anything else. He warned us about a judgment to come. And so we need to know that. So when people say, be saved, what am I saved from? You're saved from God's wrath. God poured his wrath out on the Lord Jesus Christ, but if you reject his son, his wrath that he poured on his son will be poured on you because you rejected his son whom he gave for you. And so Jesus just says here, they complain, and Jesus just says, look, no one can come unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up at the last day. There, that is a promise that Jesus gives. If you believe in me, if you trust in me, I will raise you up on the last day. Death is not the end. We know that what the Apostle Paul said in 2 Corinthians 5, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. We don't believe in soul sleep. We believe that we'll be present, but what we will be awaiting is the resurrection of our glorified bodies. And what a day that will be itself. But Jesus goes on and says here, it is written in the prophets, verse 45, and they shall all be taught by God. Therefore, everyone who has heard and learned from the Father comes to me. There is this awareness that, listen, I can manipulate. Preachers can manipulate. They can be persuasive. They can try to get you to do something, perhaps during the invitation. But except the Spirit of God works in your life, it's not going to result in salvation, not biblical salvation. It takes a work of God's Spirit. And I just say this to you, if you have a desire for the things of God, that's evidence of the Spirit working in your life. Because the natural man, Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians 2:14, the natural man does not receive the things of God. Why? Because they are spiritually discerned. So if you have any interest, any desire in the things of God, even though you may not understand a lot about it, and for those of you who have not heard me say this, Pleasant Hill, that's like saying Louise, ain't it, Miss Lucille? What was I saying? Yeah, but what was I saying? Oh, about this, yeah, about not understanding. Y'all got to help me out. Y'all got to pay attention better because I don't always know what I'm saying. You got to help me stay on track. But nobody has to understand everything. People say, I don't understand how God created the heavens and the earth. I don't know how God did this. I don't know how God did that. I don't understand the virgin birth. As Vance Hadner said, I don't understand how a black cow eats green grass and gives white milk, but I ain't going to stop eating ice cream until I figure it out. I don't understand electricity. You flip a switch and those of you who worked in electricity understand. My understanding of electricity is it will shock you. That's about all I know about it. Steve can tell you I'm not very comfortable around electricity. I don't like to mess with something that can shock you. I don't understand a combustion engine, but I'm going to get in my car and I'm going to drive home afterwards. There's a lot of things I don't understand. And so when you say, I don't understand this or that, nowhere in the Bible does it say you have to understand everything to be saved. What it does say is you must believe and be saved. By faith, you believe by faith. And Jesus just says here that if you have this interest, it's because of the work of the Father in your life and the person of the Holy Spirit. He says, verse 46, not that anyone has seen the Father except he who is from God. He has seen the Father. Most assuredly, I say to you, he who believes in me has everlasting life. I am the bread of life. And so as we've already seen in John 3:16 and verses 16 through 18 and then verse 36, Jesus said it like this. He says, For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. He who believes in him is not condemned, but he who does not believe is condemned already because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. Verse 36 of chapter 3, he says it like this at the conclusion of that chapter. He who believes in the Son has everlasting life, and he who does not believe the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abides on him. So until a person comes to a saving relationship with Jesus Christ, they are under God's wrath. While they are not yet experiencing in its fullness, it is coming unless they turn and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. And you say, well, I thought you said that God the Father must draw me. Listen, if you have any desire, that's just evidence of the Spirit's moving and working in your life. Jesus said in John 14:6, he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no man comes unto the Father except through me. There is no other way of salvation other than through Jesus, period. You can't be saved by being good enough. People will say, well, I'm a good person. Well, la-di-da. Bible doesn't say you're saved by being good. Bible says you're saved by believing in Jesus. And the trouble of that is, too often times, we want to measure our goodness based upon we look at others. Well, I'm not like those Hamas terrorists. I'm not like this person. I'm not like this mass murderer up in Maine. I've not done anything like that. And we like to compare ourselves to people that we see that we believe we're better than. Nobody ever says, well, you know, compared to Billy Graham. You know, nobody does that. Nobody says, compared to Charles Stanley, if you know who Charles Stanley who died just a little over a year ago. But if you know Adrian Rogers, who's been dead now a number of years, we don't compare ourselves to somebody we think is better than us. We compare ourselves to somebody we think is worse than us. And see, the problem with that is you're not comparing yourself to the right person, and that's Jesus. And compared to Jesus, you and I are sinners. No matter how good we may be, we've never been charged with a crime, never been given a speeding ticket or anything else that we use to base ourselves as our basis for saying we're good people. Doesn't mean that you're as bad as you could be, but listen, you're not as good as you would have to be. But the good news is you don't have to be as good as you could be or have to be. Why? Because Jesus died in your place and in my place. And so he says, I'm the bread of life. Your fathers ate the manna in the wilderness and they're dead. He said, they're dead. You want this manna from heaven. You say, our fathers ate the manna from heaven. Moses gave us, he said, Moses didn't give you that, didn't give your fathers that bread. My father did. He said, but they ate that bread and they're dead. This is the bread which comes down from heaven that one may eat of it and not die. I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. And the bread that I shall give is my flesh, which I shall give for the life of the world. He says over in John chapter 12, Jesus came for this very purpose. And that's what he's alluding to here, is his coming death, that he is going to die for the sins of the world. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. Jesus knew that he came for this. He says in John chapter 12, beginning in verse 23, but Jesus answered him, saying, the hour has come that the Son of Man should be glorified. Most assuredly, I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the ground and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it produces much grain. He who loves his life will lose it, and he who hates his life in this world will keep it for eternal life. If anyone serves me, let him follow me. And where I am, there my servant will be also. If anyone serves me, him my Father will honor. And then he says, now my soul is troubled. And what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour? But for this purpose, I came to this hour. Father, glorify your name. Jesus knew that when he came on a mission to rescue, to redeem, to ransom all those who would come to the Father, that the Father would draw to himself, that we would be saved. And he says in verse 32, and if I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all peoples to myself. This, he says, signifying by what death he would die, the death on a cross. And people say, well, how could he do that? But God, in God's sovereignty, in God's plan, it said Jesus would come. People say, well, why didn't he come today when, you know, Fox News and CNN and MSNBC and the internet could just spread the news so far? Well, look where we're at today without any of that stuff when he died. And we have the church today and churches. We have the gospel and we are to proclaim it. And it was in God's timing. And then he says here, I'm the living bread. Trust in him. Be so consumed with Jesus. Be so committed. And then he says here, verse 52, the Jews therefore quarreled among themselves, saying, how can this man give us his flesh to eat? See, they thought he was talking about, you got to eat my flesh and drink my blood. And he says here in verse 53, then Jesus said to them, most assuredly I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day. For my flesh is food indeed, and my blood is drink indeed. He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me, and I in him. So, I mean, we read that, and you think, it sounds like cannibalism. He's like, we're supposed to eat him. That's not what he's saying. See, there is a number of things that Jesus said that on first glance, you look at it, and it seems to be weird. It seems to be odd. It seems to be strange, or whatever the adjective you want to use. But what Jesus was talking about is a life that is fully committed to him. In Matthew chapter 26, when Jesus instituted the Lord's Supper, on that night that he was betrayed, but on the night before his crucifixion, the next day, he said in Matthew 26, verses 26, 27, 28, as they were eating, Jesus took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to disciples and said, take, eat, this is my body. Then he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, drink from it, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for many for the remission of sins. What Jesus was saying is, I'm going to die as that sacrificial lamb that points back to the Old Testament sacrificial system. And that offering this sacrifice, Jesus says, I am laying my life down. I am paying the price, God's wrath. I'm going to drink from the cup of God's wrath so that you don't have to. But because I'm going to do that, Jesus says, you must commit yourself to me in order to have eternal life. So when he says, eat my flesh and drink my blood, you must be so consumed with Christ. And I'll be honest with you, am I always as consumed with Christ as I ought to be? No. Are you? No. But we are to be so committed to following Christ that the things of this world begin to fade away. Listen, I love college football, and I love my Georgia Bulldogs as much as anybody. And I loved watching and listening to the game yesterday because we went to watch Sid. Tiff County's band was in a competition in Waycross, and so we went over to see her. She wanted to see her, and I said, girl, you know I got to love you to leave a Georgia-Florida game to come watch you. But we were listening on the radio, and as they were scoring those touchdowns in the second quarter, I was like, yes, yes, pile along. But as excited as I get about the Georgia Bulldogs, I ought to be that much more excited about Jesus. I ought to be excited to see somebody come to know Christ as their Lord and Savior. I ought to be excited to see somebody who has drifted away, a believer who has drifted away, that comes back and begins to live fully for Christ. Jesus says, you are to be committed to me. Why? Because he said, I was committed for you. He laid down his life for us. That is the gospel. That is the good news of the gospel. And he says in verse 57, as the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so he who feeds on me will live because of me. This is the bread which came down from heaven, not as your fathers ate the manna and are dead. We already talked about that. He who eats this bread will live forever. We're talking about eternal life. Again, you go back to John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have what? Everlasting life. Eternal life. Jesus would say to Martha, as he knew what he was going to do. But he still said this to Martha as she'd come out to meet him in John 11, verses 25 and 26. And I'm sure you may hear this at the funeral on Wednesday for Brother Orville. But Jesus said to Martha, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this?" Jesus says, "You believe in me, you'll never die. Even though your physical body may die, you don't die. If the physical body is all there is, when we die, just roll us in a ditch and let the buzzards eat us. I mean, if that's all there is, there ain't no sense in just, taking up real estate. Let the birds pick us clean and the bones bleach, let the sun bleach your bones." But we know that life is sacred because life has been made in the image of God. And life has meaning because of the Lord Jesus Christ. And he says, "You believe in me, though you may die physically, you'll never die. You will be alive." But the opposite is true. If you do not believe in Christ, you will die spiritually for all eternity in a place that God has prepared for those who have rejected him, called hell. And you will spend an eternity in torment. Jesus talked about there in hell that the worm is never filled and the fire never dies. The fire is not quenched. You say, why would a loving God send someone to hell? A loving God does not send anyone to hell. Hell is the destination of those who want nothing to do with God. So who are you to complain about a place called hell if you don't want nothing to do with him? You would not be happy in heaven if you don't want anything to do with him. But if you trust in him, you can have eternal life. But if you do not trust in him, there is no preacher that's going to be able to preach you into heaven when you have crossed that divide. When you have stepped through that doorway from time into eternity, there ain't a preacher that can pray you, preach you, or do anything else for you to get you to heaven. You must make the decision. It's not made by your parents. It's not made by your spouse. It's not made by your siblings. It's made by you personally. And so today, if you've never committed your life to Christ, and you may say, "Well, I'm a member of the church." It doesn't say anything in Scripture about members of the church will make it to heaven. It says followers of the Lord Jesus Christ. You can join a church. Matter of fact, you can join a church easier than you can join a country club. But following Jesus, come to him. And it may be today that if you sense God's Spirit moving, that today is the day you say, "Lord, I surrender all to you. I want to follow you." And if you do that, I'm going to ask you to step forward and make public that you have chosen to follow Christ. It doesn't mean you'll be perfect, but it does mean you'll be forgiven. It's not walking the aisle and taking me by the hand that is salvation. It's what you do with Jesus. And if you're a believer, if you've not been living like you should, I want to ask you today to commit yourself to follow Christ fully. Would you stand and let's pray. Father, I thank you for this day, for the opportunity to live for you. Lord, none of us are perfect. But through faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, we have the forgiveness of sin. Lord, we each need that forgiveness. Help us to commit ourselves to you, to follow you, to be led by your Spirit, that we might always honor the Lord Jesus Christ. And I ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen.
For you.
it's been good to worship with you this morning, this evening. We'll be in 1 John. Either finish it up tonight or finish it up next week. I got two parts of May. But anyway, 6 o'clock tonight. Remember, Wednesday, visitation is at 2. The service is at 3. No services Wednesday night because we'll be feeding the family after the funeral, back here, after the burial at Mill Creek Cemetery. So have your food here Wednesday. We appreciate that. If you want to carry anything by the house, you can do that. But I look forward to seeing you back here tonight, and then we'll see you on Wednesday for Brother Orville's service. Let's be dismissed with a word of prayer. Jim Cornelius, will you close us out, please, sir?